For more than a century, the haunting voice of the Iron Horse echoed across the land.
You know, there's nothing that stirs my imagination like the sound of a steam locomotive.
Steamed a sprawling landmass into a solid nation. Theirs was a call to dreamers of every age.
When I was a boy, the trains ran by my house.
My name is Glenn Gould, and this program is called...
That's the way the railroad went.
That lonesome whistle cutting through the night.
I'm a bit of a railway buff, I guess, and I've also fascinated with...
The railroads were an important part in the building of America.
What you're going to see are the designs and pictures and stories.
This program, however, brings together...
In other words, these are not going to be the interpretations of train conditions.
Brought to you by the American Railroad, the same railroad that bring you most of the food, the clothes you wear, the fuel you burn, and the things you use in your daily life.
Back in the 1800s, everybody wanted to have their tracks to their town.
That map of Iowa. Iowa. All those dark lines. All those dark lines are railroad lines.
Rock Island, Northwestern, Milwaukee, Burlington, Great Northern.
Of course, they all develop networks of branch lines.
They all went through Iowa.
There was a lot of railroads in Iowa. At one time.
So Iowa ended up with a railroad network far beyond any other state.
It was often said, and it was the truth, it was often said, you could not go 25 miles in any direction without bumping on the railroad tracks.
He said it ran about 2 years.
I don't remember anything about that at all.
Okay, well, we found that, and we're looking in the Monty book as well. We've got those two open, but we there's a lot there on the railroad, but not a lot on the about the last 2 years of its operation.
And that's what
Mark's focusing on. So.
Okay. Yeah, and I just don't recall anything at all about that.
Okay.
So I'm suspecting that, like I said, there wasn't anything in the paper.
Gotcha. Well, it's pretty
close. 70-some miles, isn't it, from Iowa City?
Right. The old right-of-way. Of course, most of it...
70-some miles. We stopped Riverside, Kelowna,
Wellman, Kinross, South English,
Webster, Jesuit, Thornburg, Gibson, Barnsey, and Montezuma. That's the way the railroad went. That's the way the railroad. That's the way.
About 19, it was 19-2 or 3.
Okay.
When Rock Island purchased this, mm-hmm. these lines. At that time, it still went all the way from Muscatine to Montezuma. And then I think it was the Iowa City Western or something that built the line from Iowa City down to this line, which they call Iowa Junction. In the 1920s.
In the 20s. Serious.
I think Dad said as late as 1949, you could ride the caboose.
I first went to work for the Rock Island in 1967, and there was an opening on the Montezuma line. We would go down to the depot in Iowa City, which still stands. And we go right through Iowa City. We stopped at every crossing. Not the cars, we would, until we got to only 6th.
Only great crossing that had flashes.
We would just whistle past that and then we were on our way.
A movie is really just a series of still pictures on a long piece of film. Each represents a slightly different point in time. Each frame is a photograph, differing only slightly from the one before it or the one taken a fraction of a second later. When projected in rapid succession, these individual pictures give the impression of one continuously moving picture.
Just a small train.
Very few cars.
The job was what they called a turn. You'd go down to Montezuma and come back. But we always had maybe at most, maybe a dozen cars.
Just a small train.
How many freight cars were there, do you remember?
Sometimes there were 10, 12.
That place was called Iowa Junction. There was a restaurant there that was open. They'd stop in there and get coffee and pie.
The first station south of Iowa City is, of course, Hills. That track still goes to Hills because of Stutzman.
That's Kelowna. You can't even tell there's more rail there.
Okay, we had lumber.
Lumber and
the railroad went right past our yard.
About 14 cars a year.
Rheaume had a tank for heating oil for the caboose. I saw him stop there one time and filled the tank. It was a cold day. The first thing they did when they got there was fill the caboose tank, and then they did their switching.
There's one place though still has the rail yet, and that's the crossing out east of town here. Might have to dig around there a little bit in the grass and stuff.
That's Wellman, all right. They're pulling a boxcar.
And we crossed the Milwaukee at South English, I think. No office, three or four hoses, tank cars of anhydrous ammonia. It's a good fertilizer. In between, I want to say Keswick and Thornburg, and there's a line going up a hill that used to go to what cheer. And we'd go into Montezuma.
And we were shipping grain on the train. And the train, just north of the elevator, they unhooked the train and went up to the turntable and turned the engines around. I could see the train from our yard when we were first American down the tracks.
Montezuma had an elevator track.
Because where the depot was in Caddy Corner across the street is still the old hotel.
Yeah, it's still
it's
there.
Standing there. It shouldn't be, but it's still standing there. But I'm sure it was used by passengers. Like, there was always in town a hotel close to the railroad.
I don't think they whistled at the street crossings in town. They just cranked that stupid bell.
In town? Well, they blew a whistle out in the country.
Yeah.
Because that's how I would know it was going. I would hear the train whistle, and then it would go across that piece of road.
The train left Montezuma going south past our home where we lived in the country.
Coming back was, that was a good ride. All that country down there is kind of bucolic.
Just a small train.
Iowa, everybody has this idea that there's a pool table. It's not. In particular, Eastern Iowa. The Rheaume was a giant at one time. At one time.
No more tickets, no more trains to ride, and many of the 1,200 stations that dotted the Great Rock Island route are gone today.
I believe the Rock Island decided that they were going to abandon the line from Hills on south and west to Montezuma.
Those that still stand are forlorn outposts of the past.
They just stopped even general maintenance.
Such a change from the days when they were the hub of civic activity.
By that time, it was a 12-hour day.
The old depot here in Iowa City, for instance, used to teem with people.
8 or 9 hours just running. No time for any kind of work.
And one by one, those trains vanished.
They looked at it as an appendage that had just outlived its usefulness.
And now the Great Rock Island route itself is sliding into the past, being carved up like some junk jalopy. And it all seems so unjust for a railroad that was once such a proud winner to die a loser.
And then they abandon it. That's how they do it.
in the early 1970s, we had huge, high grain prices, wheat prices, Soviet Union, they were buying everything we could plant and grow. And Earl Butz said, plow it up. In my district in southern Iowa, they plowed up everything. Everything. They tore out fence rows, they planted the hills, they put soybeans and they put corn in there, land had always been grazed. Because these high prices were going to extend as far as the eye could see, according to Earl Butz. Well, it lasted a few years. We had a good ride there for a few years. Got in trouble, and they lost it all in the 1980s when the downturn came. In the early 1970s.
We moved out in 70.
1970.
I moved to Iowa City in 1970.
About 1970 or 71.
November of 73, so just a month later.
In 1974.
Again, you know the story of the folks down in Kelowna not wanting to lose their rail service, thinking it's an economic disadvantage not to have it. Bought the line from the Rock Island, created the new railroad, the Central Iowa Railroad Company.
Almost 50 years ago.
I paid about $300,000, $400,000 for the railroad.
We watched this, and we see it in the newspaper. Couldn't always see trains, but you certainly could hear them going by.
You know what Thoreau said? Thoreau saw the railroad. Thoreau said they think they're going to go on with this business until everybody will ride. But when the whistle blows and the steam clears away, it will be found that a few are riding and the rest run over.
Now, this group of shippers that bought the railroad from Rock Island, I can remember two of them. One was Harlan Stubbs down in Kelowna.
Harlan Stubbs was the president.
But see, Harlan Stubbs had a fertilizer plant down the line from us.
Delgado is owned by Harlan Stubbs. Harlan Stubbs was president of the railroad. Harlan Stubbs had their engine house built on his property. And I don't know if he was a savior or a crook. I really don't know. But he was a nice guy to get along with anyway. He would call my aunt on the phone and says, we're going to run the train tomorrow.
Fred Scola was a banker. BD brought a lot of cattle in here. I wrote the checks and everything else, so. Harlan, Fred and Dua and myself, you know. We decided that's the way it's going to be.
When you go to work for the railroad, you become immersed in the entire culture. And you want to be part of it.
We had an engineer.
Central Iowa, they hired a former Milwaukee engineer.
He was an engineer.
I think he was only there that one winter.
Was he out of Oskaloosa or Ottumwa?
Do you remember
his name? He was from Ottumwa. His name was Charlie Cooper.
You knew how to drive the train.
You drove a Volkswagen.
Dale, how can you remember all this stuff?
Well, don't ask me what I had for dinner yesterday. I can tell you.
The cab was full. I mean, Charlie Gould is one of these outgoing guys. There's his son, Lloyd. Okay, there's Charlie and Lloyd and Ronnie something. After he quit. They kept operating to Iowa City, but Rock Island found out that their engineer wasn't qualified. They said, you can only come to Hills. No more Iowa City trips.
In every part of the country today, glide diesel-powered trains. 600 horsepower diesels outperform steam locomotives, General Motors diesel-powered locomotives. The diesel locomotive is spectacular. Yes, and much more. It is dependable, hard-working, and economical. These are the signs of the present, which signal for the future, full speed ahead.
So they purchased an engine that was formerly Burlington Northern.
This locomotive was here, number Burlington Northern 78, which was the one that was going to become the J33-3.
78, as I recall the number, because it was still painted Burlington Northern that set over in Hills.
440897, built 61539.
Yeah, that engine was painted 78 in green and white striping.
SW1, yeah, that's, I ran a lot of these things.
How'd they ride?
Oh, they were rough.
Then they repainted it blue, and for the Central Iowa, I think it was something like J33-3 or something like that. Had to do with biblical type stuff.
Harlan, he wanted the Bible, yeah.
It's in Jeremiah, the 33rd chapter. In the third verse, he says, call unto me, and I will answer thee and show thee great and mighty things that you do not know.
Build a building there to put it in.
And this rail couldn't handle anything too heavy anymore.
Oh, isn't that beautiful?
Man, those babies had a... This had a lot of character too.
Right, you know? Right, absolutely.
Smoke and fire and but that they were had their own sound.
Thank you.
You know, it's always seemed to me that when that first person heard that second person's voice, that they had not only the most unique experience of music in the sense of voice and sound, that original human contact, that incredible spine-tingling sense of awareness of some other human voice and persona.
With that engine came a combine.
A single passenger car.
Peggy's combine.
Painted up in their blue colors.
And a caboose, a wood caboose. Risen Northern Pacific. We had never ventured up here.
We had rides out of Kelowna. We had the caboose there.
They did one in summer, they had offered rides down in Kelowna with the engine in that car.
Train rides at Kelowna station.
We took the train back and forth. Highway 1 to Hills.
The Cobra invaders have taken Bootjack Hill. Our troops are in trouble, but here comes the G.I. Joe secret mission train.
Join the people who join the army. You could start building your tomorrows today.
While the G.I. Joe train speeds to Bootjack Hill with a secret strike force.
If you qualify, today's army will guarantee you an assignment in Europe. And you won't...
G.I. Joe 72-piece electric train and battle set complete with battleground scenic map.
When you're on what they call stick rail, joints will sink. A condition is created called harmonic roll. So what you get is a rock and roll. You think you're on a ship.
Which is probably why Rock Island abandoned the ship to begin with. Yeah. And didn't want to spend any money on it.
For some reason, there were a lot of derailments. I don't understand.
Anyhow, there's a load came in. They came and got the locomotive and they was headed out towards Montezuma. They got on the other side of hills and dumped the doggone thing, called us, and I went down and it cost us $10,000 to put it back on the track. I mean, we went to every town, then it come to Penn, and everybody dropped out. We went with a railroad with no place to take anything, so.
My impression is it didn't last more than about a year.
And then they became so spotty to catch.
I think it started tearing out in 78, although some of the track at the west end, Montezuma, and I think it tore out in 75.
To get money to keep operating.
My brother and I went down here one time. We asked some scrappers if we could have a piece of rail, and they said we could. So we took a hacksaw, we had a little oil, and sawed pieces out. Well, it probably, my arm gave out and he had to finish it though.
I was skeptical that this was ever going to really amount to anything. To run a crew from Iowa City to even to Kelowna or wherever else it was going to go, you have to haul back one car, you start to wonder.
I think there's some history of that Central Iowa Railroad that's probably not public.
It got kind of ugly in the end.
In the end, when the attorneys were getting, they were being told one thing and then absolute opposite would be occurring. Physical reminders of where the line ran through.
The combine sat down there at the end of the track in hills for years.
I mean, it sat there forever and ever, degrading.
I don't know if he stole it or if the vandals got to it.
The tracks are gone, the trains are gone.
I followed this train all the way until it quit running.
Our children would not remember it.
It was always more than a job for me.
Locomotive and everything was taken down to Hills, Iowa. And it just disappeared.
You know, but I remember it in town.
You know, Bill, I forgot about that thing. I can hear that.
The Montezuma line and the Rock Island Railroad, I was born on a bill. And I still get a little misty-eyed when I think about those days.
For me, it was kind of hard. It was like the end of the world, because I've always been a railroad fan and everything.
But they lost jobs.
Yeah. After that, there wasn't much. Dad decided to quit the coal business because he wasn't going to have it shipped in by truck. Lost the school, the creamery.
But little towns, you know, like Wellman, and we are probably going the way of many little towns along this line. This was a lively town.
Yeah, that, I mean, the Gibson's gone, Keswick, I mean, there's not much left.
Not much in any of those towns today.
Started out as a good thing for people down the line. But I guess as you progress
in what you're doing, it gets a little more complicated, costs a little more money. And so it just kind of went out.
A lot of things we did, but those things are gone now.
I think they were kind of pioneers in the railroad business, don't you? I mean, who goes out and buys a railroad? Here were four guys who probably didn't know what they were doing either, but they knew they needed, they would be beneficial to the town.
That's the weather.